one room now, I see. Hi, thanks so much for showing up. So, Alan, thank you so much for the introduction.
Up to you.
Actually, it was Nida playing in the Iron Maidens. It was not me, but we played together at an Ibanez clinic. And that was the one video you saw, right?
Exactly.
Like the tuber.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm not going to play Iron Maiden today because I just told him I used to play in an AC/DC tribute band. So there are some things I have in common with Nida playing in a tribute band. Oh, nice shirt, by the way. And yeah, I hope you guys are made out of questions after I play a little bit of music for you. I try to make it, for those of you who don't know me, I play in a band called, it's that little underground band called Evanescence. And we just finished a world tour. I played the last show on September 8th. And ever since then, I'm back in Europe, but I only spent 6 nights at home in my own bed, so I'm still going, playing a lot of guitar, spreading the word about good gear, good music. And I would like to make a little presentation of my music, which is on this fat who has this album. Oh, some of you. Nice, thank you. I'm going to be at the Ibanez booth after this, so if you want to come by and say hi and take a picture, I'll be there. I'll play a little bit of that, as well as a video that I once did underwater with the fabulous Ibanez guitarist Underwater. And I want to play that song as well for you. And of course, no, I won't. Not yet. I'll say it later. Okay, let's see. I'm scared to touch it because earlier I got a stroke here. So, as you all know, I'm a country and jazz player. So this is a complete country setup. We'll be doing some smooth jazz music now. I'm looking forward to this and. It's on my latest solo album, Insanity. And Toby is a guitar player from the German power metal band Orden Oga. We were friends, and we would meet up from time to time for breakfast, like blubbering about what's happening. And this one very day, I bought food. I bought so much food, and he didn't show up. I was left with food for breakfast for 3 weeks. And instead of having breakfast, I wrote this song. So it's called Toby Didn't Show Up for Breakfast. I hope you enjoy it. See, it's happening again. I'm getting strokes.
Estelle, I mean.
Technique, women and technique. Oh.
Thank you.
I'm playing angle amps, and I'm being attached to this chair right now. I play angle amps, I play the Powerball 2 since 800 years. I'm very, very happy with that company because that amp comes with four channels. The first one is clean, the second one is a crunch, and the third one, the lead, is my main channel because it's got just a very direct, distorted sound, and I love it. Also, what is a very nice feature of these amps, they have an integrated noise gate, which comes quite handy if you play in a high gain band like that underground band Evanescence. So we totally are happy with the noise gate, it works perfectly. And the lead channel, that would just like fry all of your faces. I will use it right now, so I'm sticking to the third channel. As well as I'm using here, as you can see, the Helix, Line 6 Helix pedal board. The story why I use it is I got the gig with Evanescence 3 years ago, and we had rehearsals, like 1 week of rehearsals. And I'm from that old school AC/DC kind of thing, so I had guitar, tuner, amp. I didn't even have I feel nice delay or something. I didn't use that. I just plug in and play. So Annie was like, oh no, you need a chorus pedal. And then Troy, the other guitar player, oh no, you need a delay. At the end of this rehearsal, I had a battery of pedals in front of me. And we played this one song called The Change. And I calculated it. It was like I should have stepped on three pedals at the same time. And I only have 2 feet. Like, how am I gonna do this? It's like jump on the pedals and play. So I went up to Line 6 and I asked them for a solution. And my favorite feature, even if it's nothing special, but my favorite feature of this Helix pedalboard, it has a so-called purple piano. The purple piano is a little simple pitch, and you can take your... Let me show it. Can I actually show it to you? Let's see. Here. Okay, so the simple pitch is a function where you can detune your guitar. So usually guitar players, we have a regular standard tuning. This is like... or a drop tuning for the... And what if, for example, somebody says, hey, can we play that song today not in D, but D flat? We would need another guitar as us guitar players. So what this pedal does, it's like... Or... And it sounds, if you detune your guitar, right? Lower the pitch of the guitar. It sometimes sounds artificial, wobbly, and not so cool. I mean, there are a lot of pedals out there who do that. But this one actually sounds good. You can detune the tuning up like two whole steps lower, which is 4 half steps lower. And that made me travel on tour with Evanescence with just 3 guitars instead of, hold your breath, 11 guitars. The first tour, Evanescence were like, are you sure you need 11 guitars? And I'm like, yeah, I'm sorry. We have a lot of tunings. So we sometimes would play, and you need spare guitars as well, because, for example, like string breaks. On a Floyd Rose guitar, you will have to have a spare one. So I traveled the first few shows with Evanescence, and I had 11 guitars. And personally, I don't like when people think I'm a rock star. I'm showing off so many guitars, like, hey, there's another guitar change. I'm like, I'd rather play one guitar. So talking about guitars, this is my favorite one. I know it's a Jam Steve Vai. Let's wait until Ivan has come up with the gen. I found this guitar and I completely fell in love with it. I had a big modification, Richie Kotzen signed it. And it has a, it's a premium model. It's not even a prestige or a super expensive. It's a very, very affordable guitar. And I did not change anything. I just play the standard version. The only thing that I have changed is that I started working with a guy called Ed Heisler. He has a company called Mad Hatter Guitar Products. Any Vi fans here? See Vi? What? Seriously? Okay, wait. Okay, good. Any Guthrie Govan fans here? Ah, better. Any Tommy Emmanuel fans here? Okay. Well, decent, then artist. Anyway, so I worked with that guy in Manhattan, Guitar Product, and what he does, it's tough for me to explain because I'm not a guitar tech, so I don't know what he wired different inside of this guitar. But I have like a little mid-boost inside of my guitar, which means... the low volume now. I don't want to kill you guys. So if you play and you would... I have a push-pull probably here now, which is literally nothing else than an incredible mid-booster inside of my guitar. Nice, isn't it? And it also... It comes really handy when you're in the studio and you're recording and you... How many of you have like recorded in the studio, like songs and albums and... Yeah. So what do you do when you... I just try to make sure that that guy fell asleep during my last clinic. I just want to make sure that you're awake now. So if you play guitar and you record it in the studio, do you do it once or do you do it twice? Like the rhythm section, rhythm part. Okay, so would you use the same sound?
No.
So you would use different frequencies. A lot of people would change the guitar for doubling. And I'm super happy with this one because I don't have to change my guitar, I just change the frequency. So it's a really cool feature. You should look it up, Matt Hatter Guitar Products. And if you write an email to Ed, please tell him Jen said hi. Okay, another song, maybe? Yeah? Okay. This song, I wrote it once and I never recorded it. So it's an ultimate clinic guitar song. It's called Indian Muffle Puff. I had changed the song title every clinic I do, so so this time it's called Indian Muffle Puff. And I hope you like it. Ouch, I'm getting strokes again. Oh. Yeah. That's not part of the song, that's the ending of the last song. And it's a theremin sound. I love it. Okay. Let's see. with this world tour we just finished. I've got to say it again, it sounds so good, world tour. I'm coming up with a new guitar project next year, so we're right now in the... We've been recording and will record. I'm doing it together with another guitar player. His name is Alan Brentini, and our project is called Something on 11. Who has seen Spinal Tap? Get it?
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, so that is the whole idea, and we want to put it out next year, Europe, the world, the moon, who knows? And it's instrumental, classic, 80s, hard rock, focused music, also with vocals because I'm also a singer. So my album is not only instrumental music, it's also with vocals. Actually, Toby didn't show up for breakfast, it's the only instrumental song. And yeah, I just want to play the first song that we put out there with Something on 11. I'm shitting my pants now a little bit because I've never played it. So, and it will be weird because Alan is not here, so I need to cover his parts. Well, we'll give it a shot, okay? Wish me luck! Okay. Pressure!
Thank you.
questions, people of Denmark. Yes, please.
Who was your inspiration for guitar?
Nuno Bettencourt. Oh, okay. I fell in love with Nuno Bettencourt at the age of 8 because of his playing. The rest followed later. Anyway, but Nuno Bettencourt, I like his way of playing because he has a very tasteful, almost cleanish sound and a very tasteful way of playing. And I am a big fan of guitar players who are paying attention to rhythms. And he's a super percussive guitar player as well, and that's what I always liked about him. Until I met him and I turned into a mute moron because I couldn't talk. It was so embarrassing. Oh my god. He was trying to keep up a decent conversation with me. I said, oh, so you play guitar? And me? Yep. Great, so you have a band. Mm-hmm. After 30 minutes, I was like, I gotta go. This is too embarrassing. But thank you for the question. Any more questions? Yes, please.
Do something warm up before you go on stage?
Yes, I do. Usually it has to do with what I play. The songs with Evanescence are not like highly demanding because it's not super fast. So I would warm up a little bit, like easy things like, you know, just make sure that stuff. As I do not play neoclassic, I hardly do I can't do that, that's too complicated for me. And most of the time just going through the songs. So I just sit here and listen to the songs that I'm going to play for you and just to get familiar with it. But especially when it's cold outside and you play open airs. I once was playing in Austria with my AC/DC tribute band back in the days. And it was snowing. I don't know who the heck comes up with the idea to put out an open air festival in the snow. So I was really like warming up for an hour just to get the blood flooded and everything. But yes, I do most of the times.
You only use the Helix as a pedal switcher?
Yes. Okay, there is one exception because with Evanescence we just toured with orchestra. And Synthesis was us musicians. It's when you hear Evanescence plus orchestra, you would guess rock band plus symphony orchestra in the back, like so many, like Metallica did it and everybody else did it. But we actually made it completely different because we were sitting inside of the orchestra. And I didn't have my amps. I only had the Helix. But for that reason, it was really perfect because we played a lot of synth sounds, dubstep-ish sounds. But as long as I have two hands and I have strong arms, I will always prefer an angle amp because nothing can replace a real tube sound for my taste. I know we're in living in a world of XFX and Headrush and Helix and Kemper, and I shouldn't even mention all these companies here, but I did. all of these options, I like the Helix the best. And as long as I can, I will always play my angle amps because I just love the sound of them.
And wonderful. How do you use the Helix? Do you have right in front or do you split it?
It's a four cable method. So for all of you who don't know the four cable method, I literally use it as an effect board. So I would use the distortion with the power of the amp, but also connect it via send and return, so I can use all the effects that are coming in here, so I don't have to, you know, make that jump on the three pedals and just have a preset and just stop on one button, which is so nice. And they come equipped with, like, I think 32 different banks. You can program, I don't know, a lifetime of sounds in that pedal board. And it can do so much more, but I still haven't understood it completely. I most of the time just use what I need to use. So if Line 6 is here for the next model and the next version of the Helix, can you integrate and build in a coffee brewer? So if there's like a coffee button, that would be so good. Yeah, and you can also use this for, is anybody home recording, like at home? You can also use this as an interface, which is really, really cool because you just connect it to your computer and you can go record. It's very, very easy, and even the handling is very easy for us guitar players who are sometimes really lazy. I mean, I'm one of the lazy ones, but some like to switch and turn knobs and do, I'm more like, I want to plug in and I want to have a great sound, and that's why I choose that equipment and that gear. What else do I use? I play Klotz cables. break guitar cables. I wear EMP shoes. And Richter guitar straps, very, very great leather straps from Germany. And that's pretty much it. So the major things is Helix, Engel, and my lovely Ibanez guitars.
Have you heard from Martin yet?
Oh yeah, but not yet. I'm waiting for them. Like, they have sent an email. I'm waiting, you know, maybe one day when I'm good and famous. So Magnus, I'm so thankful he was just here. He left. He left my clinic? What? But he was nice enough to bring me this guitar because, you know, when it comes to flight shows, it's always risky to travel with a double beat bag. And so I asked him, could you please provide me one more guitar? And he said, yes, sure, no problem. And the good thing about Ibanez is, it's, of course, every guitar is different, I agree. But still, I can come to Denmark and pick up one Ibanez guitar if it's set up right. And it will be just fine and perfect for me to play. Just go plug in and it will be fine. And I really like those Prestige models. They have a little bit, the neck is a little bit too thin for my personal taste. This is a premium model, but it's a jam, so it's something in between the Prestige and the Richie Kotzen Taylor, which is more like baseball. But this chair, the chair, I get attached to the chair. So the one tune I would like to play for you on this guitar now. Isn't she just the most beautiful guitar I've ever seen? I never get tired of looking at her. She's so beautiful. This one is beautiful too. Don't feel like I didn't appreciate you. I do appreciate you. You're beautiful too. Let's see. I cannot leave this chair without at least playing a little bit of Evanescence for you, right? Who are, by the way, who are Evanescence fans? Woo, big time. Wow. Two. Have you been to one show? Because you have a t-shirt.
Yeah, I saw the group in LA.
Oh, you've been to LA? Are you from Denmark or from
yeah,
LA?
Denmark.
You traveled from, wait a minute, have you been at the meet and greet?
I didn't go to the meet and greet, no. I have to get a P-Tech.
Wow. See, Evanescence has crazy fans traveling from Denmark to LA.
Oh, yes.
Where have you been?
London. In March.
Yes.
Both stage.
Sweet! Lovely to have you back. So nice. You know, we went to the LA show and came to see the show. I'm usually not starstruck and I never shit my pants, but Eddie Van Halen came out to see. He was apparently, so the story, I'll talk fast so I can do it. Apparently, Evanescence had a tour manager touring with them. And he left the tour with Evanescence because he got the call to tour manage Van Halen. And he was like, guys, I love you, but sorry, I have to do this. So apparently that tour manager called up Troy, our other guitar player, and said, oh, you know, I know it's very complicated with LA shows and guest lists, and I don't even know if it's possible, but Eddie would like to come and see your show. And we've all been like, what? Done, check mark. And until that very evening, nobody knew if it's showing up. It was like a myth. The myth of Eddie and Hale coming to the Evanescence show. And then I joined a cello gram, which was our opening act on the last tour. It's Dave Egger and Chuck Palmer, like a cello guy and a percussionist, also does program DJ stuff. And I joined them for playing Cashmere. I liked it. So I got stage left, got my guitar, the pack, my in-ears, and I walked past Amy's dressing room on the way to the stage. I had like a minute left to go on stage. And I saw Eddie there. I was like, what? And I walked back. Oh my god, it's Eddie Van Halen! So I had nothing. I had a Sharpie with me, and I walked up to him, holding my guitar. I was like, could you please sign, please? I mean, hi, nice to meet you, but could you please sign now? And he was like, what a weirdo guitar player. Okay, he signed my guitar. I was like, thank you very much. I have to go play a song now. Bye. Yeah. That's the way I met Eddie Van Halen. Great chat. You probably think of me like a weird guitar player of Evanescence. Hey! Okay, so we're up for a little bit of Evanescence music, right?
Yes.
I'm not playing the synthesis, ouch! I'm not playing the synthesis versions because that was a lot of synth sounds, synthesis. I'm playing the old school rock version, so enjoy. I hope I still remember. Look at me, I can change the pitch without even... Yeah. Because with Evanescence, we have a lot of seven strings and baritone guitars and like the. I relearned for this medley, I relearned some songs because I would play them on a seventh string, but regular standard tuning and drop D tuning and seventh string, and then probably another seventh string in drop tuning is too much wood. So I relearned the songs a little bit different than I usually play them on the seventh string. But yes, it's drop D!
When you record the next album, do you have a studio at home or do you use the laptop and do you use the angle or
Okay, for demo recording, I use exactly what you see here. I work with Cubase and I sometimes would even run my guitar through, through a THR Yamaha amp because they're tiny and cute and sweet. If I record for an album, I would always go into a studio. Because for my taste, it makes, I don't like plugins. Plugins are nice and sweet, you know, you can work with them for demos and collect ideas. But when it comes to studio recordings, I want to hear that loudness of an amp. I want to hear the tube sounds and I need a cab, then I need to feel the microphone in front of the cab. So I will always go into a studio. The same thing with, and I would like to quote my friend Glenn Fricker, I would never have programmed, hey! Can I just hear a phone? Who was that? I would never program drums. I want to hear the sweat of a drummer when he's playing. And program drums are nice for collecting ideas, but when it comes to recording, I'm super old school. Super old school. I would like to have my amp. I would like to have a sweaty drummer. I mean, drumming. And okay, one more question. Who gets the last question? Because I just learned that there is another clinic after this taking place today, right? Is that
right,
Alan?
Yes, there's something we decided to
do. So who is playing? Because it's not in the program.
Don't ask me.
What?
Yeah, where are you?
Help.
We'll tell you when this is over. We'll tell you the name. It's a secret.
Hey!
Until it's over.
I just said hey. So we'll have another clinic here after I finish blubbering, so you should all stay and come back for another fabulous Eidenes guitar player.
Helen Holmberg.
Ah, you know that guy? I just saw him play. He's great. So I'll probably be downstairs at the Eidenes booth a little bit, but probably come back here and watch Helen play a little bit. Okay, last question. There was somewhere there. Yeah.
What's the thing just going to do?
These are the questions we guitar players love. It's 9 to 46, the Dario. And I've been using them forever. And I love them. Especially the NX, I can't remember. NXYL. Is that correct?
YXL.
Yes. These are the best. And I use a Pig Boy Carbon Picks with the blue writing, I don't know, what is it? 0.88 milliliters with the blue writing on it. What else? That's all. That's all I got. So I hope you guys enjoyed it. And I hope you will follow Something on 11 on Instagram and Facebook. Because we want to come back to Rock Denmark in spring next year. And fabulous to see all of you again. Thank you so much, and thank you, Alan, for this great Copenhagen Guitar Show. It's my first time here. I'm excited, and hope you all enjoy it too. Thank you very much!